9, verses 4 to 5. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name.
That you're here joining us this morning. Yes. We pray that you will be blessed today because we just love the Lord. We're on fire for the Lord, and we want you to be on fire for the Lord as well. Before we get started, let's just open up in prayer. Father, I just love you. I thank you for who you are today.
You
are mighty. You are powerful.
Hallelujah.
You are gracious and kind.
Glory to Jesus.
I just pray that you, Father God, would just bless us this morning.
Hallelujah.
Bless us as we go into worship, into the Word. I pray that it would be so clear, and I pray that our hearts would be so full this morning.
Yes, Lord.
With the anointing of your Holy Spirit, we give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor, because you alone are worthy to be praised.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen.
Thank you.
sacrifice my open heart. I offer up my life. I look to you, Lord, and your love that never ends restores me.
You be lifted high in my
Jesus, you be lifted high. You be lifted high. You be lifted high. You be lifted high in my life, oh God. And I fall to my knees, so it's you. They may see not I. Jesus, you be lifted high.
Good morning, Agape. It's a great honor to be here once again with you. I pray that you have your Bibles, your notebooks. We're going to take lots of notes today because we're going to be talking about a man that's very well known and a story that's well familiar with lots of adults and especially children. Children that attend Sunday school, they learn the story of Daniel and the lion's den. You can ask any student or Bible individuals, what's your favorite story? They might say Noah and the Ark. They might say Daniel and the lion's den. They might say Moses. They might say Jesus' birth. But a lot of times, individuals would talk about Daniel and the lion's den. We're going to be focusing on Daniel and the lion's den. So if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Daniel chapter 6. We're going to start with verse 5. We're going to skip. It's a long chapter, but we're going to just highlight on some of the scriptures today. So we're going to start with Daniel chapter 6, verse 5. Finally, these men said, "We will never find any basis for charges against this man Daniel unless it is something to do with the law of his God." Verse 10. Now, then Daniel, when he learned of the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the window opened towards Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to God just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree. "Did you not publish a decree during the next 30 days? Anyone who prays to any god or human being except you, your majesty, would be thrown into the lion's den?" The king answered, "The decree stands in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repelled." Then they said to the king, "Daniel, who is the one, an exile from Judea, pays no attention to you, your majesty, or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays three times a day." Verse 16. So the king gave order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." Down to verse 20. Then he came near the den, which was the king. Then he came near the den. He called to Daniel in an anguished voice, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" Down to verse 21. Daniel answered, "May the king live forever. My God sent an angel, and he shut the mouths of the lion. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight, nor have I done any wrong before you, your majesty." Verse 27, "He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions." Today, as we study about Daniel, I want to ask you the question, How well do you know the story of Daniel? How well do you know about his character? How well do we know Daniel this morning? We want to talk about that. But I know that we're studying from chapter 6, but I want to just review what happened in chapter 1. First of all, we want to know the principles of Daniel today. First of all, we know that Daniel is from a royal family. He was in Jerusalem, and King Nebuchadnezzar wanted some young men in his kingdom, his palace, to serve. So he sends his officials to Jerusalem from Babylon to go to Jerusalem and gather these young men. But there is qualifications for these young men. These young men had to be strong, they had to be handsome, they had to be intelligent, they had to have wisdom in different topics of life. So we see that Daniel was one of them that was captured and brought to Babylon, which is at least 800 miles away from Jerusalem. And we see that Daniel had to do some training for 3 years, and he was trained in different languages and in literature and the culture of Babylon. We see that he was also 10 times wiser than all the other young men in that time. We see that God blessed Daniel with the gift of knowing, interpreting dreams and visions. He also explained riddles, and Daniel was very good in solving difficult problems as they arose the time he was in the palace. God used Daniel in a mighty way, but there's something else about Daniel. Not only was he smart, not only was he good looking, but he had a powerful relationship with God Almighty. The Bible says in the first chapter that Daniel refused to defile himself. Daniel refused to defile himself by participating and eating from the king's food and wines. Daniel had a strong conviction due to his covenant with his God. Daniel purposed in his heart to be faithful to God. Daniel was worthy in his walk with the Lord. Also, Daniel, as a young man, he was 15 years old when he was snatched away from his home. They say, the scholars say, that he was a young man. Many of them say he was 14, 15. But let's say he was 15 years old at this time. Apparently, his parents did a great job raising Daniel and having a commitment with God. Daniel was faithful to God. Daniel was devoted to God. And also, Daniel was a young man of prayer. Prayer was important to Daniel. Daniel was so committed to the Lord that prayer moved the hand of God when he would pray. Another thing about Daniel, God was the center of Daniel's life. May we be like Daniel. May God be the center of our lives. Not only that, but in every circumstance in the Bible of Daniel, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, you will see that Daniel sought the Lord for whatever circumstance arose in his era. Not only did he sought the Lord, but Daniel was faced with a lot of difficulties, temptations, and trials in his young life. He was always surrounded by pressure of sin, constantly being around Babylon. He was constantly under pressure to compromise with sin. But there was something about Daniel. He was so strong in his conviction in living a holy life before God. I believe that he believed Deuteronomy chapter 6:5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. That was Daniel. With all that was in Daniel, he was determined to love the Lord and serve the Lord. What about Joshua chapter 22, verse 5? Love the Lord your God, walk in all his ways, and keep his commandments. I believe that's what Daniel did. He took the word of God in his heart, and he was determined, according to his strong convictions, not to compromise with sin. He had high standards, and he was not going to lower them for anyone. So he was committed to God. He didn't waver in his walk with the Lord. There's something about Daniel that I get overwhelmed. With all his greatness in the first chapters of the book of Daniel, Daniel never had a spirit of pride. Daniel was a humble man. The way he talked with people was with respect and humility. There is something beautiful about Daniel. He never had a proud spirit. He never had a show-off spirit. He never had a condemning spirit. I'm better than you, or my God is better than your God. He was just a man of humility. He never showed pride. He was humble and submissive to God. Another thing about Daniel, when he prayed, for example, like chapter 2, we see that a king had a dream. And he told his wise men, you need to tell me what my dream means, and I'm not going to tell you the dream. You need to tell me what I dream and give me the interpretation. If you cannot do that, then you are going to be cut in pieces. And we see that that was a threat, because the king was overwhelmed with this dream and he wanted an interpretation. He wanted to know what this dream meant. And we see that Daniel, in the story, he heard about what was happening, the commotion that was going on. Daniel and his friends got together and they sought the Lord. And we see that the Lord gave Daniel the interpretation of the dream that the king had. So we see that he goes to King Nebuchadnezzar at that time. And he says, I know the interpretation of your dream. I give God all the glory because he revealed this interpretation of the dream that has been troubling you for days. I have the interpretation. And he gives them the meaning of the dream. Even through that, his co-workers were saved and they were not cut in pieces, because Daniel sought the Lord and God gave him the revelation, the meaning of the dream that the king had. And the men were rescued. He was rescued. And we see that there was no pride. And Daniel gives credit to God for revealing the secret, the secrets of life. We see that Daniel, from there, he goes on and he grows in the Lord and he grows in different promotions, as we read in this scripture. As we fast forward now we know that Daniel was captured from Jerusalem. He lives in Babylon. He's 15 years old. He goes through training. He prays. He's faithful. He loves the Lord. He's committed. He's not falling into the traps of sin. Now, years later, going into this chapter, chapter 6, now Daniel is in his 80s. He's 80 years old. He is still serving the Lord. He is still going from promotion to promotion. Now, this is the third king that Daniel is serving under, and this is King Darius. We see that Nebuchadnezzar, his son, they passed away. Now, Daniel is under the leadership of King Darius. And King Darius admires Daniel because of his wisdom, because he's different, distinguished from the other wise men in the palace of the king. Daniel was so unique that he stood out, that it says in the scriptures that we read, first of all, the king admired him. Secondly, the king puts him in one of the high positions. There was three individuals that were going to be administrators, almost like a president of the kingdom. So he was one of the administrators out of the three. And the king wanted to, and his plan was to set Daniel over all his kingdom, over all his kingdom, over all the co-workers that were under him, under all the, he was going to be overseeing all the governors, all the administrators. He was going to have this high position. He was highly favored by the king. But we see there was a problem. Daniel, his co-workers, the president, the governors, everyone under him were so jealous of Daniel. They had an issue with Daniel. They didn't like that the king loved and admired Daniel over them. This jealousy that festered within his co-workers was so demonic, so evil, that we see that Daniel becomes a victim. He becomes a victim of their evil plot. We see that these men don't like Daniel. They have a problem with Daniel. And we see that they are trying to find a way to accuse him, a way to shame him, a way to belittle him. But they looked, they investigated, they searched, and they couldn't find anything. The Bible says that Daniel had an excellent spirit. What does that mean? He had a positive attitude. He worked so skillful. He was one that was honest and faithful. There was no corruption in him. That's why being in high position, probably a lot of the co-workers were thieves. Probably they were corrupted in different ways of dealing with the king's taxes and money and whatever it might have been. But when it came down to Daniel, there was no fault in him. The Bible says in many different translations that there was no fault in Daniel. Daniel had a positive attitude. He was so on with God. He followed God's commandments. He was faithful in everything he did. It reminds me like in our era when individuals go out to office, like presidents or congressmen or whatever it might be, there's always individuals trying to find some kind of skeleton in people's closets, trying to find some kind of dirt, trying to make them look bad in front of the media, in front of the news, whatever it might be. They try to find dirt on someone. But we see here it happened the same. I think this went on for many years before our era today. Even in Daniel's time, they were trying to find something to accuse him, but they couldn't. The Bible says there was no dirt on Daniel. There was no corruption on his part. He was a godly man. He was a righteous man. He was a holy man, walking every day with God. And the men came to a conclusion. We can't find anything on Daniel, but there's something that we can probably work on. And so they worked on it. They came up with a plot, and the plot was the only thing that we can come up is against his God. They knew that Daniel was a man of prayer. They knew that Daniel was a man that prayed morning, noon, and night. They knew that Daniel was an open book to everyone in his belief in God. They knew that Daniel was a man of prayer in public and in private. They knew that Daniel was one that was so pure in his commitment with God. They knew that Daniel was not corrupted in any way. So we see that they come up with this evil plot. Wow, these enemies, when I was reading the scriptures, his enemies despised him. Not only did they want to discredit Daniel, but they wanted to kill Daniel. Wow, I'm glad I don't have friends like that. I might have some friends or individuals that don't like me because of my belief or because I'm a servant of the Lord or because I preach the gospel. But here we have Daniel. His friends not only attack his prayer life, but they want him murdered. And so these young men got together and they came up with the plot. So they go to the king, and first of all, they lied to the king. They deceived the king with their plot. We see that they go to the king and they share with the king, "King, why don't you do this decree?" And the decree is that for 30 days, no one should pray to their God, and no one is to ask anything of any human except you, O Majesty, O King. So the king was very impressed, and so he thought that sounds like a good decree. But we see that the king thought that everyone was in agreement, even Daniel, but Daniel was not even there in the scene. So we see that also the wicked men said, do this decree that it cannot be revoked, that it cannot be changed. Once it's written, and you have to follow the command of the decree. So we see that the king thought, well, that's a good gesture. So he goes ahead and he writes this, the law for 30 days. Can you imagine not praying for 30 days? I was thinking on this, not to pray for 30 days, that would kill me. That alone will kill my walk with the Lord. I would dry up. I would be miserable. I would be falling in sin if I didn't pray. When I pray, it's direct communication with God. It's like Daniel. When Daniel prayed, he gave thanks to God. When Daniel prayed, he was asking the Lord for guidance and for help. Can you imagine going 30 days without praying to God? Well, this was the decree. And we see that once it was published, once it was posted everywhere, we see that Daniel read the decree. But Daniel disobeyed the decree. What? He disobeyed? Yes. You know why? Because God was more important to him than the decree. God was more important in his life than life itself. Daniel knew where breath came from. That was the living God. Daniel knew where his battles came from. That was through the living God. Daniel knew where his strength came and the wisdom came was from the living God. So we see that Daniel, once he hears and he reads the decree, it says that he went upstairs to his home and he walked into his home. He opened the windows and he was faced Jerusalem. Even though Daniel was in Babylon for 65 years, he lived in Babylon, but his heart was in Jerusalem. He lived in Babylon, but his heart was in Jerusalem. That's why he faced Jerusalem. He prayed. That evening, he prayed, and his co-workers, his enemies that were so jealous of him went to his house and they saw Daniel praying and asking help from God. So these men that spied on Daniel and saw Daniel praying, they ran to the king and they said to the king, King, do you remember that decree that you made? And the king says, yes, it stands today. And so these men, these wicked men, these men full of jealousy, full of hatred, they remind the king of the decree that he signed. He says, well, there is one in your kingdom, under your kingdom, one that you have appointed high in position. He has disobeyed you. He has not listened to your decree. And he prays three times a day. You know, that was Daniel's commitment to the Lord. For 65 years, he prayed every day, morning, noon, and evening. For 65 years, he was committed to prayer. That was his life. So we see that these men are telling the king, he's praying three times a day. He hasn't changed his ways. He is still committed to praying to a God. His God. And so the king tried his best to revoke, to change the decree. He even had probably his wise men to look and see if there's anything that can happen to rescue Daniel. He liked and he admired Daniel for his faithfulness and his godliness. We see that there was no way, there was nothing that can be done. What was done was done. What was written, and there was no way to change it. So we see that because there was no way, the king calls for Daniel, and we see that they throw Daniel into the lion's den. And we see that the king admired him so well that he even tells Daniel, he says, Daniel,
The God that you serve, I pray that he would rescue you. The God that you're constantly serving, I pray he rescues you. That was the king's desire. So we see they put him into the lion's den. How many lions? We don't know. But there was quite a bit of them. And a lion, I looked it up. Do you know that lions, a male lion can get as big as 350 to 500 pounds? And a female can go up to 250 pounds to 350. I mean, these are big creatures. These are big animals. And we see that they throw him into the lion's den. That night, the king could not sleep. That night, there was no entertainment for the king. That night, the king fast. Not only did the king fast, but the lions fast all night as well. We see that while the king could not sleep, he was restless. He regret falling into this trap. He was so upset that there was nothing he could have done to reverse his mistake. So we see that on the other side, Daniel is in the lion's den. Daniel was innocent before God. He didn't do anything. He lived a holy life. He relied on God. He trusted in God. And we see he's in the lion's den. But something miraculous happened to him. Something powerful took place in Daniel's atmosphere, being in the bottom of this lion's den. God sends an angel, and the angel stops the mouth of the lions, and they're not able to have a great dinner. They were not able to eat Daniel. We see that these lions had to fast all night, but we can picture, and I'm a visual person. I can just picture Daniel just praising the Lord, just giving God all the glory and all the honor. I can picture him thanking him in this circumstance. Do you know, brothers and sisters, that we go through our own lion's den? I've been through a lot of lion dens. It might not be the actual where there was lions around, but we all go through, just, you know, as a symbol, we all go through our lion's den. We all have situations. We all face crisis. We all face trials, tribulations. I've been in some serious lion's dens, and I had to rely on God just like Daniel did. I had to pray just like Daniel did, and I am so grateful that God came through for me. He was able to get me out of this situation. Many times he was able to do miracles and get me out of the lion's den. We see that Daniel is there in the lion's den. I believe he's praising God. I believe as he's seeing the angel, he's rejoicing. I believe that he is just having a hallelujah time with the Lord. And early dawn, the Bible says that the king gets up and he runs to where Daniel is. And we see that he's calling out. He probably tells his workers, move that big rock, move it out. I want to see if Daniel is still alive. We see that with an anguish, the Bible says that with a desperate yell, he's yelling from his lungs, Daniel, Daniel. Did the God that you serve continually, was he able to deliver you? Was he able to rescue you? And at the bottom of the pit, Daniel looks up and says, O king, live forever. My God sent an angel and has shut the lion's mouth. I am fine. I was found innocent before the sight of God, and I am innocent before you. I have not done anything to hurt you or to discredit you. I've been innocent before God. So they get Daniel out of the lion's den. But the story doesn't end there. The story comes to the conclusion of this, where everyone that lied, everyone that came against Daniel gave an account. We see that the king was so disappointed that these men that he had in his kingdom that were his right-hand men, men that were supposed to oversee the kingdom, men that were supposed to be upright in their dealings with his kingdom, were wicked. They had a wicked heart of jealousy, a wicked heart of destruction, a wicked heart that came to plot against an innocent man. And we see that the king, he was so glad that Daniel was rescued. And we see that Daniel was so proud and excited, he was promoted again. But not only was he promoted, but his enemies, his co-workers that framed him were cast into the lion's den. The Bible says that the king threw all the men that came against Daniel, threw him into the lion's den. Some say that by the time their bodies landed or still falling down to the pit, that the lions grabbed him and crushed their bones before they landed to the floor. We see that not only were the men persecuted in the lion's den, it says that even their wives and their children were thrown into the lion's den. Oh my goodness, but I love the writing. After that took place, I love the writing that the king did. He wrote this decree that everyone in the land should worship the living God of Daniel. This is what he says. He says, Daniel's God, he rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders. I love that. Our God does save. Thank you, Jesus. Our God does save us. Our God does rescue us. Our God does signs and wonders. Many of you can write books on the goodness of God. Many of you can write books of how God sought you through. You might have been sick to the point of death, and God rescued and saved you. You would probably were going to be crushed in an accident, but God came and saved you. Many of you were accused like Daniel, accused of something that you did wrong, but you were innocent and God saved you and rescued you. Many times we have gone through trials, tribulations, and hardships, but God came to rescue us. Oh my goodness, when I read of Daniel, I want to be like Daniel. I want to have a pure heart. I want to have a clean heart like Daniel. I want to be a woman known as faithful, trustworthy, honest. I want to have those qualities that Daniel had. But above all, I want to have the prayer life like Daniel had. How many times have we said, Lord, from this day forward, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to praise you three times a day. I'm going to do it, Lord, or throughout the day, I'm going to do it. I am so determined to be a woman of prayer, and I pray you are determined to be a man of prayer, because prayer moves the hand of God. Prayer is where the action is. Prayer is where I need guidance from God. Prayer is where I lean on God and not on my own understanding. Prayer is humbling myself before God, seeking Him, trusting in Him, and turning away from my wicked ways so God can heal me, heal my circumstances, heal my family, so I can be counted worthy as a woman of prayer. It reminds me of a story. A little girl went to Sunday school. And that evening, Mama was helping her get to bed, putting on her pajamas. And the little girl, when it came to her shoes, she kicks her shoes and throws them under the bed. She throws the left one and the right one under the bed. And Mama says, daughter, why are you throwing your shoes under the bed? You're going to need them in the morning when you go to school. The little girl looked at Mama and said, Mama, today in Sunday school, I learned about a man. His name was Daniel, and he was a man of prayer. So when I heard the story, Mommy, I want to be like Daniel. So the reason why I put my shoes under the bed is because in the morning when I go to school, I need to get my shoes, and it's going to cause me to drop myself to my knees to look for my shoes under the bed. I want to drop to my knees, Mama, because I want to be like Daniel. I want to be a little girl that knows how to pray like Daniel. And I want God to see me through in my struggles in school, just like God helped Daniel. I want God to help me. So we see even little children understand the story, how important it is to pray. Here's a little girl that was willing to change her attitude to be like Daniel. I pray that this message will stir us. Could it be possible for a young person to serve the Lord and purpose in his heart or her heart not to defile herself or himself before the Lord? Yes. Daniel did it at the age of 15. Could it be possible to serve the Lord all these years and be faithful to God and walk with God humbly, walk with God, trusting God for all things, even in difficult situations? It can. For 65 years, Daniel prayed and he sought the Lord. Now he's 80 years old and still seeking the Lord. Oh, age has no limits to what God can do. Even at the age of 80, God was using Daniel. Daniel was going to oversee the kingdom with the king. We see that at the age of 80, he was faithful. I pray, brothers and sisters, that we will be faithful as well. And I just pray that if your prayer life is lacking, or if your prayer life is not where it should be, today we can make a change. Today we can say, God, forgive me. I repent. I repent for not being committed in prayer. I repent for not praying to you. Forgive me. I repent for not listening to you when you have spoken to me. But I pray that today your prayer life would change. I pray that this message would move us to pray like Daniel prayed. I pray that this message would cause us to be faithful like Daniel was faithful. I pray that we would be honest with ourselves and say, God, I need you in my life. I can't live this life without you. And I need you, Lord, because I don't want any skeletons in my closet, in my heart. I want to have a pure heart. I want to be clean. May I, Father God, be an open book to my friends. May my friends and my relatives know that I am a woman or a man that believes in God. May they know that I'm determined to serve the Lord. My friends might be doing what they want to do, what the world does, but I am determined and purpose in my heart to serve the Lord and to follow the Lord. I pray that that would be you today. And if your relationship with God has lacked, and you have no relationship at all with God, you can have a relationship with God. He loves you. Jesus died for you. He's not here to condemn you. He's not here to belittle you and criticize you. That's not Jesus' style. Jesus loves you and longs to have a relationship with you. Jesus wants to be the savior of your life. He's the savior of my life. Am I perfect? No, but I'm striving to have an excellent spirit like Daniel. Do I make mistakes? Yes, but I have a God that forgives me. That's who I want to recommend to you today. Jesus Christ, the living God that loves you so much. He loves you so much. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you for your word. And I pray that you would just convict us to be more like Daniel, having a heart after you, loving you, committing ourselves to you, our ways, our future. Lord, I know you have plans for us. Your plans are not to harm us. Your plans is that we would be prosperous in you, walking upright with you. We want to be committed in our walk with you. We want to love you. We want to surrender to you. Every day, Lord, renew our minds. Renew our commitment with you. I pray that people that are struggling with their walk with you, Lord, that you would heal them, that you would just embrace them right now, that you would surround them with so much of your love and your peace and your joy. I pray that you would just start a new chapter with them today, and that from this day forward, they would seek you and love you with all their heart, with all their strength, with all their soul, Lord God. I thank you and I praise you because you are God, you are powerful, and you love them. If there's people that are sick and afflicted today, I pray that you would heal them from the top of their heads to the sole of their feet. I pray that you would breathe in them, Lord, the breath of healing, the anointing of healing. Your tender kindness of healing would be active in their bodies. Heal people with stomach problems, Lord. Heal people with migraine headaches, Lord. People that are suffering from their legs. People that are suffering, Father God, from their heart. I pray that you would heal them and strengthen them. I pray for a miracle. I'm like this king. This king said, he's the God of signs and wonders. Lord, do signs and wonders in these bodies that are hurting, because you know how to rescue and you know how to save. Bless your people today. May they rejoice and may they be committed to worship you all day long. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters. Praise God.